Praise the Lord. Amen. It's good to be here with you in fellowship and sharing God's word. I believe before any outreach, whether it is preaching the gospel or teaching in a Bible study or traveling anywhere, I believe the most important thing that I can do as a Christian is to pray before I go. I believe that prayer is the most important thing that we can do, seeking God and getting God's leading and the direction of His Holy Spirit. And when we seek God in prayer, He does lead. He does great things. He does wonderful things when we seek Him in prayer. And any ministry that's embarked upon, that's not sourced or soaked in prayer, is an insult to God. It's only the flesh. It's only men's own doings, only waste of time. It's only a puff of smoke. I was coming up yesterday, and because of the gospel trailer, it's a much longer journey. But I knew that there was a couple of matches on in Croke Park in Dublin, but I was avoiding the city centre. And this van passed me like a rocket, and it was obviously from Armagh. I don't know how he got the number of flags in that van that he had on it. The Armagh flags, they were after winning a match. But you know something? I had the best flag coming up that road, all the way from Limerick yesterday. The scripture says in Psalm 60, verse 4, "Thou hast given a banner to them that fear thee, that it may be displayed because of the truth. Selah." I thank God for His precious word. And I believe in the power of the word of God. Thank God for that hymn. There's power in Jesus' blood. I was sitting inside in Bertie's prayer room and a brother contacted me by text. And he said, "I had a lovely thought," he said. "There's power in the blood," he said, "to wash every sin away." And I said, "You're right, brother." You couldn't argue with that. And I thank God for that hymn and that other hymn that was picked at the start. It's a beautiful hymn. I never heard it before. It was a blessing to hear it. I want to turn to the Word of God in Revelation chapter 20. Thank you for the invitation to come. And I'm glad to be here and to be enabled of God. I use that term more and more in recent times, enabled of God. We are enabled of God. Jesus says, "Without me you can do nothing." We can say that and learn it off and say, "I know that scripture." But are you conscious of it? Are you aware of it every day? "Without me," Jesus says, "ye can do nothing." And in this portion of scripture, I asked the Lord, I said, "Are you sure, Lord, this is what you want me to speak on?" And in Revelation chapter 20, we're going to read from verse 11 to verse 15. And I pray that God will speak to you. I believe that this is for all of us tonight. It's about the great white throne judgment, but there's more in the message than just the actual judgment. In verse 11, we read, "And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away. And there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire." This is the second death. "And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire." Now maybe you've come across this in your studies of God's word, but I want to point out something to you this morning here in relation to God's word. John got a revelation from God, and he's talking about things that he saw happened. And if you go to the start of Revelation and go the whole way through, because I've done it, you will find the words, "And I saw," or "I beheld," or "I looked." You'll find them approximately, because I might be wrong in my counting, 47 times. John says, "And I saw." Now, if we go back to the start of Revelation, and if you have your Bible with you, and you should have your Bible with you, I'm going to read the first few verses. "The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him, to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John, who bear record of the word of God and of the testimony of Jesus Christ, and of all things that he saw. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. How much more is the time at hand today than when this was penned? How much more are we nearing the end of the age? How much more are we nearing the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ? How much more are we nearing the point in time when it'll be too late for sinners to turn to the Lord Jesus Christ? Verse 9, John says, I, John, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation and in the kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was in the isle that is called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day and heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet. You know something? We need to be in the Spirit on the Lord's day. He says, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. And God showed him all that he was shown, and he pinned it down. And we're going to look at a small portion of it, but a very serious portion of God's word. Verse 11 of Revelation 20 says, and I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. I'm going to go back to Revelation chapter 6 to read a few verses here. Revelation chapter 6. And listen to this. Verse 14. And the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places. And the kings of the earth and the great men and the rich men and the chief captains and the mighty men and every bondman and every free man hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? And when I see this portion of Scripture, verse 16 of Revelation 6, where it says, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb, the thing that comes to me is no more mercy. Mercy is over. Mercy is finished. It's too late. And these people, when we think about the Lamb who sits on the throne, for those who are truly saved, he's the blessed Lamb of God. John the Baptist says, behold the Lamb of God which takes away the sins of the world. We can look to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. He is our encouragement, he's our joy, he's our blessing. He's the one that lifts us up when we're down. He's the one that rescues us when we're in despair. He's the one that is the cause of our joy, the source of our happiness. He's the one that has given us a reason for living and looking forward to heaven. But the same Lamb and the same God, the same one that sits on the throne, is the one that they want to be hidden from. In our reading it says, from whose face, verse 11 of Revelation 20, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. Why would they want to flee from the Lord Jesus Christ? Why would they want to be anywhere except to look at him? Because they'll have rejected him. They'll have lived their lives and rejected him. They'll have lived their lives and have had no thought for him, no concern for him whatsoever. And here is the consequence. Here is a certain consequence for all those who rejected the Lord Jesus Christ. But I'm very concerned in recent years, friends, about people who call themselves Christians and are not walking with God. I'm very concerned about people who call themselves Christians and do not spend time in the Word of God. I did not get up out of bed this morning and come to this meeting. When I was coming and leaving home, and days before I left home, my only concern about coming up here was to be ready and prepared before God and to seek God in prayer and to check with God and say, Lord, have I got it wrong here? Are you sure this is what you want me to share? And I'm concerned and I'm afraid this morning for people who go to Christian meetings and may not be saved at all. What we think of God's word is exactly what we think of the Lord Jesus Christ. The time that you have for this word of God is the time you have for Jesus Christ. Don't be fooled or deceived this morning. If you're not in the word of God, you're certainly not in the spirit of God. You're not being led by the spirit of God. We need to be in the word of God in the days in which we're living. We are going to be tested. We are going to be tried. And I'll tell you something. COVID was only a sample of a test. That was only a sample of a test. It's going to cost us to be Christians. We're going to be found out if we're not believers. It's going to cost us. It cost the Lord Jesus Christ his life's blood. Cost him everything. Everything. He held nothing back. And the Bible tells us of these people from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. You know, the judgment of the damned, or the great white throne judgment, it's a very, very different judgment to the court case situation that we're used to in this world. You've the counsel for the defense and you've the counsel for the prosecution. There's only one counsel at the judgment, at the great white throne judgment. God. Start to finish. God. There's no defense. There's no arguments. And those who are trying to flee in from the face of him who sits upon the throne, they know their number is up. They know this is it. I pray sincerely today. And one of the prayers I prayed before coming here, I said, Lord, I said, will you please work in the hearts and minds and lives of the people who will be at that meeting? There's got to be someone here today that's got to hear something from God. Now, I can't tell you anything. I can't make you think any particular way. But the word of God has got to get through to us. This is very serious. There's no defense at the great white throne judgment. And the Bible tells us in the next verse 12, it says, I saw the dead. And I stopped and I thought about it. Wow, I saw the dead. That's some description, isn't it? I saw the dead. The Apostle John says, stand before God. Small and great, stand before God. No distinction. It doesn't matter whether they did well in this earth or not, whether they were poor or rich or affluent or qualified or not qualified. I saw the dead, small and great. And when I saw that, when it says I saw the dead, I was thinking of, that's the complete opposite to the dead in Christ. The dead in Christ. We know from Thessalonians that the Lord, when he comes back, that the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we which are alive shall be caught up together with them, and we will meet them in the clouds, and so shall we be ever with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. But that's the dead in Christ. Those who died knowing Christ. These are those who rejected Christ. He says, I saw the dead. Both small and great stand before God. And the books were opened. I'm a very simple person when it comes to studying the Bible. Some people talk about commentaries. Well, my commentary is the Bible. My commentary is the Bible. I'm not interested in commentaries at all. I'll read God's word. If necessary, I'll read it 20, 30, 40, 50 times. I'll read it over and over again because it's a spiritual book and the Holy Spirit will show me God's word. And the books were opened. Now that tells me there's more than one book. The books are open means there has to be two books. But just when it says and the books are opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. So there's definitely three books. There's definitely three books. And the dead, again, the second reference to the dead. The dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. Now, let's go to John chapter 12 and verse 48. John chapter 12, verse 48. What you think of the word of God is exactly what you think of Jesus. You can sing whatever chorus or hymn you want to sing. You can go to conventions. You can go to 20 meetings a week. It doesn't matter what you think of the word of God. And the time you give to the word of God is the time that you have for the Lord Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ is the word made flesh. So let's see what he says here in verse 48 of John chapter 12. Jesus is speaking and he says these words. He says, he that rejected me and receiveth not my words hath one that judgeth him. The word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day. So one of the experiences of the dead, referred to as the dead, those who are damned, those who are judged to be damned for all eternity. One of the experiences that they'll encounter is the very word that no time for on earth is going to judge them on that day. That's what Jesus said in his word in the last day. The word of God that they will have written, I've no time for that. No. I remember some person saying many, many years ago, I don't need the Bible, we have the Holy Spirit. Did you ever hear such nonsense in all your life? The Holy Spirit will never work independent of the word of God. We need to be people. And if you're sitting here today and you're listening to me, and maybe I could be irritating you a little bit, because you mightn't be reading your Bible like you should be. You mightn't be in the word of God like you should be. But you need to start today and you need to say, Lord, give me a desire for your word. Give me a desire for your word. You cannot call yourself a Christian, a true Christian, and not have a desire for the word of God. I'm telling you that before God is my judge listening to me today. You cannot call yourself a Christian and not have any time for the word of God. That's a fact. People who know the Lord Jesus Christ love his word. They love the word of God. They love the gospel. They believe in the power of the gospel. It's not just something that you go and you go preaching here or there. I mean, if I didn't believe that the gospel wasn't the power of God unto salvation, what's the point in preaching it if you don't believe in the power of God? It's the power of God. But there's so many people going to churches who don't believe that the gospel is the power of God. And that's one reason why they're not witnessing or sharing the gospel. Now, I brought a fist of tracts with me today. And on it, it says in the front, it says, Lord Jesus, I'm sorry, forgive me my sins. And it's a concise testimony that I have. And I have a challenge for you here today. I'm going to ask you to do something today. Take one of those tracts and give it to an unsaved person. Do not give it to a Christian. Do not give it to another Christian. Give it to an unsaved person. Now, if you're afraid to do that, ask God to give you someone on your path. Lord, give me someone to give that to. And I believe that God's word will not return void. You see, so often we can be listening to this message and we can listen to that message and this preacher and that preacher, and we're going to this convention and going to this outreach and so on. We're not witnessing for Christ ourselves. We are witnesses. If we're Christians, we are witnesses. How could we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved from the wrath of God and saved from hell, so terrible a place. How could we be saved and not keep it to ourselves? How could we not want others to know about this Saviour, about this blessed Redeemer who's changed our lives from darkness to light, from going to hell to going to heaven? How could we not want others to know? Sure, even the lepers knew better when they said, "We do not well today," and all the spoil was theirs. And praise God, the whole nation was rescued and saved because they decided to do what was right. They went back into the city and they said that the Syrians have fled, and they had all the booty and all the goodies that the Syrians had left, the provision of God. There's enough Christians, if we say we're Christians, to have a revival across our land. If the Christians that say they're Christians would just be Christians, stand up for God, be a witness for God. And if you're full of the fear of men, go home before you have your dinner today and go into the bathroom and look in the mirror and say, "Would you, Lord, take the fear of man out of me and put the fear of God in me?" The fear of God will help you overcome the fear of man. The fear of God will drive the fear of man out of you. And when we don't have the fear of God, we're so self-centered. Everything is about ourselves. I, me, and my. Everything. That's why people are depressed. That's why so many professing Christians are depressed. Because they're thinking of themselves all the time. And they're in a black hole of depression. And the devil is laughing at them. And they'll persecute those who are trying to help them. Oh, that we could fix our eyes on Jesus. And oh, that we could get our eyes fixed on him. And oh, that we would, the word of God would take a hold of us. That we would be able to say like Paul, "Knowing the terror of the Lord, we persuade men." I said to the Lord, I said, "Lord, give me that terror. Help me to know that terror. That we would persuade men." If we could see the flames of hell licking around their souls and are only a breath away from hell, oh, we would go to the edge of the cliff just to rescue them. And we wouldn't be too worried about what they think of us or what they're going to say to us. Because the devil is whispering in our ear saying, "She's going to say this and she's going to say that." You don't know what they're going to say until you open your mouth. And it's never as bad when we open our mouth for God. When we tell the truth for God. And they did, the Bible tells us, were judged out of those things which were written in the books, according to their works. The books were opened. You know, for those people at that great white throne judgment, to be judged according to their works is an absolute terror. No person could describe what that'll be like. According to their works. You see, if I was judged according to my works, I'd be damned in hell and I'd be burning already in hell. And I wouldn't have an argument against it because I deserve it. And all our works are all our own righteousness, the Bible says in Isaiah, are as filthy rags. We're not good enough to get to heaven. Our works aren't good enough. Our works are sourced in sin. Our works originate in sin. We're sinners to the bone. Nobody had to tell us how to sin. Nobody had to teach us. We didn't have to get educated to sin. It came natural to us. Some of us are nicer sinners than others, and we can dress ourselves up and we can present ourselves in the best possible way, but we're sinners to the bone. And as sinners, we're doomed to die, heading for hell. I remember I was visiting in a home some time ago in Tipperary. It's a good few years ago. I think it was a Church of Ireland minister was there. And he was there anyway, and he was there with his, anyway, whatever. And they were sitting down on the couch, and I walked in, and I said, "A right bunch of sinners we have here today." He nearly cleared the old couch running out the door. The very mention of sin. "A right bunch of sinners we have here today." And of course the host was thinking, "Boys, he wasn't too impressed with what you said." But sure, isn't that what he should be saying? Isn't that what he should be preaching? There'll be a special treatment in hell for those who call themselves ministers and will not preach the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. The love of God and the judgment of God. You can't separate them. This Lamb that sits upon the throne, who will be the joy of those who are redeemed, who cannot wait to see Jesus Christ, who cannot wait to see the one who died for them, the one who shed his precious blood, the one who walked up to Calvary. This same Jesus will be a terror, the sight of whom will be a terror to those who attend the great white throne judgment. God forbid that there be one person here that will be at that great white throne judgment. Because there'll be no negotiations at that. It's all done and dusted. They'll be judged according to their works. According to their works, every sin that was ever committed, every wicked thought, every evil imagination, everything that you might have think would be totally forgotten, every sin will be accounted for. Why? Because God the Father will honour the death of his Son. Jesus on Calvary's cross paid for all our sins. In his precious blood, forever, he shed his blood to wash us from every sin. And you can be absolutely sure that those who decide to live their life without that blood cleansing them from their sin, without coming to him in repentance and being born again, you can be sure that God the Father will oversee that every single sin that his Son died for on the cross will be paid for in eternity. But it's a payment that will never be finalized. I can't even begin to imagine it. It's a payment that will go on forever and ever and ever. You say, why? Well, I know why for me. I don't understand the seriousness of sin. I don't understand the awfulness of sin. And those who stand there will be judged according to their works. The Bible tells us in verse 13, and the sea give up the dead which are in it. And death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to their works. I'm so glad this morning standing here that the Lord didn't judge me according to my works. I thank God that I didn't wake up in hell this morning. I thank God that Jesus Christ saved me when he did in November 1979. I thank God he didn't take me in my sin. And there's lots of things I don't have the answer to. I'm not one of the people that can say to you today, I understand the book of Revelation from start to finish. And I'm not ashamed to say there's so much I don't understand. But what I don't understand, I leave it with God. But I understand what is said here about the great white throne judgment. And if you're here today and you're not saved, that's where you're heading. You're heading, this is set in stone. John saw it. He's talking about something he saw. He didn't say, I'm going to see. He didn't say about some future date. He said, I saw. 47 times he said, I saw. God showed him. Why did he show him? For us, for our benefit, for our warning. As you sit here today, if you hear nothing in this meeting, hear this. Don't go to that judgment. Make sure you're saved. Make sure you're right with God. Make sure you're in a right standing with God. If God has to deal with you, say today, deal with me now, Lord. But don't deal with me there. There's no representation at the great white throne of judgment. There's no prayer intercession. Prayers are finished, gone. No more prayers. The praying is to be done now. The seeking God is to be done now. Family members going to hell. I pray, I said, Lord, I said about one of my sons, I said, if I never see him again, Lord, I'm asking you to save him. I'll give up. I don't mind not seeing him again. But I am asking you to save him, Lord. That's the bottom line for me. But we have a good God. And I did see him again. And I saw my grandson. We have a gracious God. We have a wonderful Savior. Do you know Jesus as a wonderful Savior? Or is this just a bitter religion for you? If you're not reading your Bible, it's only a bitter religion. No point going out there and going into the car and commenting one way or other. I don't care what people think of my sermon this morning. I don't care. If I cared what people think, I wouldn't be pulling that trailer around Ireland. If I care, I don't care what people think. It doesn't bother me in the least. But I do care this. God is able to speak through his word like that. And he can convert a person in an instant. He can cause the hardest sinner to turn to him because he did it for me. And if you're honest tonight or this morning, he did it for you if you're a saved sinner. So often we forget what the Lord has done for us. And that's when we're not telling others because we forgot what he did for us. If we remembered afresh what he's done for us, we'd be busy telling others, fueling the furtherance of the gospel, witnessing to the unsaved, getting out there, give out a tract, leave a tract in the dentist surgery or wherever you're going. Say something for God. Open your mouth for God. There was an old man staying in my house, and he's a godly man. Very, very timid, but he's a godly man. And you know, he went for a walk. He went out every morning. He was staying in my house. He's in his 80s, up from the top of Donegal. And he went down for a walk, and the next thing, he was down near the graveyard, walking down near the graveyard, and he heard some screaming, absolutely shocking screaming. And then this woman ran out of a house and started running towards him, and of course, he didn't know what to say. And he just looked at her, and she kind of stopped, and he says, "Jesus loves you," he says. She turned around as if to say, "I better go somewhere else." And he said it louder. He said, "Jesus loves you," he said. And she turned around again and she said, "Thank you." She said, "Thank you." Have you told someone recently that Jesus loves you? Have you told someone recently that Jesus wants to save you? Or did he just want to save you and me and let the rest off? I can't stand these people who call themselves Christians, who go on about the elect. And I praise God for the elect. And I praise God for predestination. And I praise God for free will. But I can't stand these people who use predestination and free will to sit in their backsides do nothing. I have no time for them. And the reason I was asked to a particular place to preach, but I didn't like the way the goalposts were moved. And I thank God that I didn't go there to preach, because I wouldn't be responsible for what I'd say. Dead cold religion, calling themselves Christians, opening up their Bibles, and the unsaved have more chance gone into them as they have of walking across the Shannon. God help us in the day in which we're living. God help us. The sea gave up the dead, and the death and hell gave up the dead that were in them. There's nowhere, no one excluded. Every person that refuses to come to Christ, every person that's not truly born again, will be at the great white throne judgment. What about you? What about you? Will you be at the great white throne judgment? And it says death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And I go back to chapter 19 and I read the following. In verse 20, listen to this. "And the beast was taken, and with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, with which he deceived them that had received the mark of the beast and them that worshipped his image." Listen to this. "These were both cast alive into the lake of fire burning with brimstone." That's some company in hell, isn't it? That's some company in the lake of fire. Verse 10 of chapter 20 says, "And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever." The devil that deceived them. You cannot believe one solitary word of what the media is telling us. And they're talking about global warming and climate change. It's a load of rubbish. It's a load of nonsense. It's a lie from the pit of hell. There are changes taking place in the climate. There are changes. It's the coming of Jesus Christ. And it's the devil's answer to tell people this is what's happening. It's global warming. It's climate change. It's not climate change they need to be concerned about. It's not global warming that they need to be concerned about. It's the great white throne judgment that they need to be concerned about. That they don't under any circumstances find themselves at that judgment. There's no place found for them to hide them, for to hide from the face of the Lamb. Thank God for the face of Jesus this morning is such a blessing for the child of God, such an encouragement, but such a terror it will be for those who have rejected him and this side of eternity. And we read that the Bible says in verse 14 of Revelation 20, and death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Luke chapter 10, verse 20. Says the following. I'll read from verse 17. Luke chapter 10, verse 17. And the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. I can understand their enthusiasm. Can you? I can understand their enthusiasm. And he said unto them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions, and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Notwithstanding in this, rejoice not, that the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice, because your names are written in heaven. I want to ask you this morning, is your name written in heaven? When was your name written in heaven? Is your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? Are you truly saved? You know, saved doesn't mean being in a Christian family. Saved doesn't mean that your father's a minister or your mother is involved in the church work or whatever, or that you go to these meetings on a regular basis. Were you born again? Have you come to the Lord Jesus Christ with your sin, and have you been saved by grace? Can you point to a time, can you point to a situation in your life where you say, I came and I was saved by grace? But you know, in the parable of the sower, you get that the seed is good. I want to point that out. The seed is good because the seed is the word of God. But there are different conditions, and there's only one condition in the parable of the sower that speaks of salvation, and that's the good ground. And you know it in the parable of the sower, it says they have no root in themselves and so endure for a while. And it talks about temptation because of the word and they fall away. That's not salvation. That's not salvation. Salvation is having your sins forgiven, being born again and walking with God and being a disciple of Jesus Christ and following him. Salvation is an experience whereby you have a definite relationship with God. And if you're here today and you don't have that relationship with God, how do you know where you stand? Where do you stand? What's the real story with your life? What's the real situation? I mean, when you get up in the morning, what do you do first thing in the morning? What's the most important thing in any given day? If you're a Christian, you say, I'm a Christian. What's the most important thing for you as a Christian? Is it not your walk with God? Is it not to be in some way used of God? Oh yes, we fail and we come short to God's glory every day, sometimes many times during the day. But is there a consciousness of God? Is there a consciousness of God going to bed at night? Is there an awareness of God? Have you set your life in such a way as that God is getting a particular part of your time for dedication, for consecration, for communion with him, and nothing is to interfere with that? Or is it a casual thing that we'll go to the meeting and we'll get a blessing and it'll last till I get back out to the car and I just revert back to the way I was? That's not salvation. That's not Christianity. Christianity is following Jesus Christ. It doesn't matter whether you're a young person, or it doesn't matter whether you're a middle-aged person, or whether you're an old person. What matters is, are you walking with God? Are you in communion with him today? Are you following him? Do you know what it is to hear God's voice? Have you heard him speaking to you lately? Have you heard him asking you to turn? Have you heard him asking you to go back? Have you heard him asking you to wait? Have you heard his voice? It's a very strange sort of a concept of Christianity if you don't hear your Father's voice. My sheep hear my voice. That's what Jesus says. Whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. There'll be no more prayer. There'll be no more mercy. It's judgment time. And you know something? We cannot gamble with that date. And God has seen fit in his wisdom not to show us, but he's seen fit in his wisdom to say, watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. We're going to be tried. And there's wicked laws coming out on the level. The laws are coming out. They're not even democratically being put out. They're being put out. It's satanic. The system is satanic. It's an antichrist system. The whole system. Even the simple things that you are interacting with government agencies and government bodies that used to be some bit straightforward. Everything is a problem now. Everything has become more difficult. Why? Because it's antichrist. We're looking for someone to come along with a horns in their head and a tail and a fork. The antichrist system is well advanced. But we need to raise up the banner of Christ's word. And we need to get out there with the gospel of Christ and start living for God and bringing the prayer into our home. Bringing the prayer into our families and praying for our loved ones that are not saved. I mean, if we care for our loved ones, we'd be praying for them. Seeking God, crying out to God. But there's one way you wouldn't be praying for them. If you're not saved yourself. If you're not saved yourself, why would you be praying for them? It is you that needs prayer. I pray today that God will help us and help me. And I'm conscious, you know, we get older and it gets harder to do the things we used to do so easily. And it gets harder as you get older. But I pray to God to get the gospel of Jesus Christ out to as many people as possible. I thank God, since we started giving out John's Gospels, we've got approximately 70,000 John's Gospels given out. God has provided them. And in recent times, I had Bibles in my house. And I know that God's people provided those Bibles. And I thank God for them. I thank God for them. And I had a few boxes. And I said, Lord, I said, I don't want you to come back and these Bibles be in my house. I said, I don't want them to be in my house when you come back. And every single Bible that has come in recent times into my house has gone out, has gone out, has gone out. And very many of them through my brother, faithful brother in the Lord, Pat Cribben, who's gone out, and many, many young people are reading their Bibles. They're reading their Bibles. There's something happening. There's something happening. God says, in the last days I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. We need to take our eyes off what the devil is doing and fix our eyes on what God is doing and get our eyes upon God and see what God can do. And we need to start witnessing and we need to stop being ashamed of the gospel of Christ. And we need to bring our Bibles to church and we need to be people of the Bible and we need to be stop apologizing for the word of God. All the other wicked religions, they shove it up our noses. It's time for us to stand up for God. It's time for us to be witnesses. Nail your colours to the mast. The safest place is in the front line. Why? Because God will take care of the back. The safest place is in the front line. Because if you think that you'll be safe in the bunker at the back of your house, once you're down in that bunker in the dark and cold, thinking that you're safe from all that's going to happen, the devil will want the bunker as well. There's no place to hide. And it's time for us to stand up. It's time for us to stand up and be counted. I want to encourage you, challenge you, and warn you as you go home today. Spend time in prayer. Set aside time in prayer. If you find it hard to pray, you ever see someone drinking a glass of water? Some people take a glass of water and they drink it all in one go. Now, if I was at home, I'd probably do that, but I want to be more respectful. And they take a sip and then they leave it down. You say, I can't spend an hour in prayer. Spend a half an hour in prayer. I can't spend a half an hour in prayer. Spend 15 minutes in prayer. And then open up your Bible. And read your Bible. And then spend another 15 minutes in prayer. Do it. And you'll be blessed. And you'll never regret it. And I'll tell you this, that if God gets a hold of your life through prayer, He can reach so, so many people. Thousands can be won by one person and sold out for God. And get into the place of prayer. And if you can support a prayer meeting, go to it. Go and support the prayer meeting, because others will be encouraged, because they'll say, oh, I wasn't going to come, but I'm so glad now I came now. I wasn't expecting to see you tonight. I'm so encouraged. And you know, another person's in prayer, we encourage each other. We encourage each other in fellowship. We encourage each other through the word of God. In my house tonight, there'll be a small little gathering of people, and they'll be meeting, and I haven't a doubt in my mind they're going to be blessed. Why? Because they come to me with Jesus. And there's a young couple, and his name, the lad's name is James from Galilee. His wife is Helena, she's from France, and they are on fire for God. On fire for God. And they want the word of God. And even though they're not long saved, they have a discernment. They don't want the watered down Mickey Mouse versions. They want the word of God. The pure, unadulterated word of God, forever settled in heaven. They want the word of God. And they are thrilled to hear and to get the word of God. Well, you give God a chance. Don't be judging prayer and judging what it means to be dedicated to the Lord. I used to hate the word sanctification. I used to hate that word. And I'm speaking as a Christian. Why did I hate that word? Because it reminded me of my old religion. And I didn't want to associate with that. But you read John chapter 17 and Jesus is talking to his heavenly Father. There's a lovely chapter to read today. Jesus is talking to his heavenly Father and you can listen to every word he said. It's absolutely dynamite. And he says to his Father, he says, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. And I see this word sanctify and I said to myself, oh, I thought that was a bad word. All Holy Joe and Holy Mary stuff. The old dead religion. No, it doesn't mean that at all. It means become more like Jesus. It means get closer to God. So you open up the word of God and I open up the word of God and I have the same challenge. I said to the Lord over and over again recently, I said, Lord, I'm asking you to bring my children to prayer, those that are saved. I said, if it's this hard for me, how hard must it be for them? And I said, bring me to prayer as well. Bring me to prayer. Bring me to prayer, because the devil is attacking our prayer lives. But as we come to prayer in the word of God, God will speak to us through his word and he'll clean out our minds from the filth of the world and the unbelief and all those rotten things that pull us down every day. And God revives us and he says, I'm in charge. God arranged for us to have the book of Revelation. God arranged for John to already have seen what's going to come to pass. John says, I saw 48 times. I saw. God showed it to him. And I want to tell you in closing tonight, I'm glad that John saw the devil that deceived them cast into the lake of fire and brimstone. And I praise God for that this morning, that the devil was cast in to the lake of fire and brimstone. And I praise God that though the Bible says he comes about as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour and he knows his time is short, but praise God it's shorter than it was yesterday. And the day is fast approaching, the time is fast approaching, when the dirty devil will be cast into hell and he'll never get out again. But what will it be like for those who join him from the great white throne judgment? You're sitting here today and if you're not saved, the thought of it, think about it. What will it be like to have company for all eternity in hell with the devil and all these dirty demons and every wicked, horrible disease and plague you couldn't even imagine. We couldn't even begin to imagine. But for those who are saved, the Bible says they shall see his face. We'll go to that place where there'll be no more sickness, no more sorrow. There'll be no more pain, no more hurt, no more trauma, no more tribulation, no more persecution. The place of eternal joy, eye has not seen, neither ear heard, neither is it entered into the heart of men, the things that God has prepared for them that love him. All you got to do today is to love Jesus. And if you're a Christian and you've gone back and you've given ground to the old enemy, come back to the Lord and say, Lord, set my heart on fire again. Stir me up again, Lord. Move me by your Holy Spirit. Give me a love for God. Give me a desire for God. Give me a zeal for God. You won't get that in the meeting. You've got to pray yourself. You've got to draw aside and give time to God. You've got to come to Him. Come with whatever way you're able and say, Lord, here I am. I want more. I want to get closer to you. I need to get closer to you. It'll be too hard in the days we're heading into for those who have one foot in the world and the other foot in the company of God's people. It won't be possible. It's our make our mind up time. It's time for us to get right with God. And I pray sincerely that God will bless and encourage and challenge you today. I'd rather speak about something else other than the great white throne judgment. But then again, I'm bound to share what God gives me to share. And I pray that God will speak to you today and encourage you. You know something? If you go home today and spend a little time in prayer that you wouldn't have spent last Sunday, you might be on the right road. And say, Lord, bring me to prayer and do whatever you have to do. I prayed that prayer 1,000 times before God brought me to prayer. I prayed it over and over and over again. I said, Lord, bring me to prayer. And I'll tell you this before God, the most important thing I'll do before this day is out is have time with God, alone with God in prayer. And whatever way I feel tonight, the last thing I want to do before I go to bed is to be in the company and presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I thank God that as I stand here today, there's a prayer rota gone on, and it's gone on for 4 years and five months. Some of the people are too old to even be partaking in it now. And I thank God for what those prayers have accomplished. I thank God for the people who have come in again and again and again and again. And I know some of them and the burdens and the persecutions that they go through. And they're coming back to prayer, coming back to prayer. Our God is a faithful God. He says, them that honour me, I'll honour. If you're praying and it's hard, keep praying. If you're praying and you're discouraged, keep praying. There's a breakthrough coming. Don't give up. Keep praying. God will give the breakthrough. God will answer prayer. We have a faithful God who hears and answers prayer. He does it His way. He won't do it our way. He'll do it to please Himself. And I thank God for His grace to stand here today. I thank God for His word. And I thank God, especially as I stand here, that we didn't wake up in hell this morning. Because if I was in hell right now, I couldn't argue a bit against it because of what my sins did to Jesus on Calvary's cross. And we're only here because of being sorry for our sins. And we could only be sorry by the grace of God. It wasn't something that we came on ourselves. It was the grace of God, the mercy of God. For by grace you're saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. And praise God, our boasting is in Jesus. Our boasting is in His precious blood. Thank God for that song. There's power in Jesus' blood to wash me from my sins. Praise God for the blood of Jesus that cleanses us from all sins. But we need to come to Him and we need to give our lives to Him. We have a close in Him and it's 315. And it's I've wandered far away from God. In closing, I just want to say to you, please, if you're not right with God, get right with Him now. Whatever schedule you have on today, whatever plans you've on, you get right with God right now. You make that decision. You put your trust in the Lord. Because I'll tell you something, the devil will fill your schedule. And if you're not saved, you'll be at that great white throne judgment. And if you're saved here and you're going on with God, praise God, that's what we've been spared. Praise God, He didn't give us what we deserved. Thank God for His mercy. Be encouraged today. And if I can help you in any way, and again, those tracts at the back, take a tract, give it to an unsaved person. And if you're not going to do that, leave it there. But if you're going to take it, you give it to an unsaved person, and there'll be a story in heaven. You'll get it when you get to heaven. There'll be a story in heaven because of God's precious word. So let's sing this song, and we'll close in prayer.
Now I've come.
for your mercy and your love to us. We thank you for amazing grace. Lord, how well those words were penned. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. We thank you for your mercy. Lord, in wrath you remembered mercy. But we pray for mercy, Lord, for the multitudes all around us that are still going on that way to hell. Help us to reach them while there's time. Help us, Lord, give us the desire. Give us a love for the lost, I pray. But Lord, bring us to prayer and into your word, that your word would be more precious to us, and that, Lord, people would see that we are the disciples of God. Fill us with the love of God. Give us a burden, dear God, to come to you, even today in prayer. Help us, meet with us in prayer, Lord, we ask. There's nothing, dear God, like the blessedness of in your company and in communion with God. And we pray that as we go from this place, we might be a bit different. We might come closer to you. Lord, please help us not to look in the mirror and forget what we see. But help us, Lord, to take the challenge of the word of God. And we plead with you, dear God, for our loved ones who are still not saved. Lord, that they would never, ever find themselves at that great white throne judgment, where there'll be no more pleading, no more mercy, no more prayers. Lord, it'll have been too late. We pray, dear God, that they would see Jesus' face with joy to beholding him. Lord, I ask it in your blessed name, and I thank you for our time today. Bless us now as we part. And Lord, keep us looking to thee in Jesus' name. Put the devil under our feet, Lord. Give us victory over the devil in Jesus' name. And we pray, O God, for many precious souls to be saved in these days. Amen.